Yes. Good morning. It's a pleasure being here with all of you. My name is Carlos Romero. I'm working at Segitur. I'm Director of Research, Development and Innovation. We have just 45 minutes and six, we're missing one panelist, six, seven panelists. I'm going to do a very briefly, quickly introduction of each one of them, just the name and their position, and they're going to introduce to you their major areas of interest from their chairs or with a very brief presentation. And after that, we're going to get into the discussion if we can. okay, so very, very quickly, we have here people from different companies with different backgrounds. I have Grete Bergsland, Director of Innovation Norway in Madrid. And they are going to tell us about what they've done and what they are pushing in Norway in relation with e-mobility and smart mobility. Diane Robino, Global Tourism Partnership from MasterCard. And probably all of us, we are thinking on MasterCard as a company working on things related with credit card payments. But they are a huge a global technology company, and she's going to tell us about all of that and its relation with the travel sector. We have Juan Villalba, global Ignacio, Ignacio Tovar, sorry, because the order is different. Well, Ignacio Tovar, head of digital transformation from Iberia. He joined Iberia very recently, and he's responsible for boosting digitalization in a huge airline as Iberia. And probably he would tell us also about some experiences they have launched in relation with promoting startups related with the airline sector and activity. Close to him, we have Ignacio Pérez Carasa, Director of Institutional Relations of ALSA, one of our major international coach companies in Spain. I'm glad you make it to join us. And Jonathan Americo, product manager of Smart Cities.
He's Jonathan.
from TomTom. Hi. So great to have you here. Finally,
Julio
Echenique from Ericsson, and they're going to tell us about networks and the importance of smart grids in relation with smart mobility. So please, some of them have prepared a very briefly 3-4 minutes presentation, and others are going to tell us directly from their seats. We're going to start with Innovation Norway. Please.
Use the clicker.
Yes, Brett.
Good. Can everybody hear me if I talk like this? Yeah.
No please.
No. Then, no, please. Okay. Then I will stand here. Oh, I can use the microphone. Thank you. Yeah. So I'm from Innovation Norway, and I'm here to talk about what is happening in Norway when it comes to mobility, and specifically e-mobility, because some of you may be aware, but many are not, that quietly in the Northern Europe there has been happening and is happening a small revolution when it comes to mobility. This is the number of e-vehicles in Norway. Little tiny Norway, about 5 million people. So you can look at the figures and compare it to the, these are not percentages, these are numbers of cars. compared with the rest of Europe. So how did this happen? Of course, there has been a very clear strategy from the government for many years. They have given tax incentives to move people over to electric vehicles. So buying a Tesla in Norway, buying a car in Norway is expensive. Buying a Tesla, however, is much cheaper than a similar car that goes on diesel or on gasoline. And if you have an electric vehicle, you don't pay any tolls. You can go in the public transport lanes. You park for free. So there are a lot of incentives that have really over time pushed Norwegians into electric cars. And now more than 50% of the cars sold in Norway are electric. This is a mature market now. So the development has actually given the government confidence to say that in less than 7 years, no diesel or petrol cars will be sold in Norway. It's not going to be possible to buy it anymore. Okay, in the previous session that I was in, we talked a lot about construction. How does that work? And what is probably not mentioned when we think about the construction sector is transport. Because we know in cities that emissions from construction sites, transport related to construction sites, is almost as high as the emissions from cars, if you look at the percentages here. And not to mention the noise pollution. So this is an area where you can really make an impact through innovation. And in Norway, thanks to public-private collaboration, that's a reality now. We have the first emission-free construction site in Norway. And it's because the government is putting it into their public procurement tenders. And of course, this creates not just a better city, but it also creates innovation and business opportunities for the private sector. And the same trend can be seen at sea. In 7 years, again, the Norwegian World Heritage Fjords, which is one of our main selling points when it comes to tourism, will be the first zero emission zones at sea. And fully electric ferries have already been operating in Norwegian fjords for years. You see the first one in the world up there. I've been on it. It's fantastic. The goal is that in the future, all the ferries that run along our coast will be electric. And finally, we see the same happening also in the air. Very ambitious goals for our domestic air traffic to be fully electric by 2040. And to be prove it can be done, they have just put their first electric plane in the air last month in Norway. So to sum up, of course, this hasn't happened by itself. There's been many hurdles along the way, and there still are a lot of innovations that have to happen for some of these things to become a reality. But I think the key learnings have been early support from the government is crucial. And the legal incentives, the procurement framework has to be there. And for the private sector, you know, a possibility to get access to a larger market and to be able to scale. Otherwise, there's no point for them to do it. So that was a quick summary of what's happening in Norway. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, it's amazing what you've done. If we consider that it is a country in which approximately 22% of the GDP depends on the extraction of gas and oil, no? So so most of it you export it, no? Instead of yes. Inside.
Yeah. In Norway, 98% of the energy consumption is renewables. So we don't use the oil and gas ourselves for private consumption.
Send it to Europe.
We send it to Europe and other places. But of course, this is also part of our incentive because we know there is happening, the energy mix is going to change, and we're not going to be able to live off the oil and gas maybe in the future the same way we had. So forcing ourselves also to create new industry and moving our jobs to in a different direction, in a greener direction, in a more sustainable direction, has been a big part, I think, of the incentive for us to that we see this as part of our evolvement and to create a more sustainable industry that's not so dependent on oil and gas extraction.
Okay, yeah. Thank you, Brett. So let's move to Diane. I told you that I was looking at the your intervention at the WTTC recently in Buenos Aires, and you were talking about why you are not just a credit card company, no? What is MasterCard about? I mean, what are you doing, and why your link with mobility and smart mobility, no? How it fits, no? Please tell it.
Definitely. Thank you for the opportunity, actually, to speak about that. Yes, we're actually very well known and probably known as a credit card company. Interesting enough, we don't issue credit cards. We have the network where all these cards run. So we connect issuers, consumers, and merchants in terms of these transactions. And we're talking about a presence in over 210 countries and territories around the globe, about over 2 billion cards around the globe, and connecting over 2,100 banks or financial institutions. That's what we're very well known for. But at the end, at the core, we're a technology company. And what we were talking in Buenos Aires is about how we can have a role in the digital transformation of the tourism sector. We're very well known for what we do in the travel ecosystem, and we have been participating for as many years as we have existed in terms of tourism and what the tourism sector is trying to achieve in terms of digitalizing the mobility across borders. We have biometric solutions that have been used in financial services and have been engineered to actually operate and in other different sectors. Definitely the digitalization of transactions is critical. This is how we are actually involved with our efforts on smart cities. We're currently working with over 100 cities and their transit infrastructure. Why? Because as you all will know, about 70%, in the next generation, about 70% of the population of the world is going to be living in cities. Now, very few cities are really prepared to take on this increasing demand. And the digitalization is really critical. 65% of all the fares in transit are paid by cash. And if they're paid by cash, that means somebody is standing at a line, buying a ticket. There's a visitor trying to figure out how to buy a ticket in a foreign country, right? That also takes time and actually changes the flow of people in a station. And then you have countries or cities trying to work with interoperability of their transit systems. So we have been very involved in providing solutions that digitalize and automate and make these cash transactions, actually, digital transactions, transactions that are done with the card that you might have in your pocket, with your phone, sometimes with wearables, your Apple Watch. It can be also with a ring, some metro stations, even with your shoes, if you have the right shoes. So at the end of the day, this is what we want. We want convenience, right? But what we want to do is also improve the life of the citizens of those cities. The reality is that they need to cope with the flow of visitors, and but they need to benefit from the economic opportunity of those tourists coming in. But at the end of the day, they need to get to work or to school quickly. So having the right platform where you have digitalized transactions and you facilitate this flow in the transit system has been actually quite successful. We started back a few years ago before the London Olympics, because of course there was gonna be a great inflow of visitors, and the challenge was how can we actually help and facilitate this. And we actually, the last quote that we saw on Twitter, because of course these are numbers that they share publicly now with us, is that the City of London saves about £100 million a year because of the introduction of these additional ways of payments and contactless payments in the system besides their Oyster card. So a lot to be done, a lot to benefit from for both citizens, visitors, and governments, and we're excited to work with that. We also work with some cities on demand management. So recently we had actually a pilot with the city of Chicago on demand management, and this is through text messages, pretty much giving them some insight on, you know, the how crowded the system is. And the pilot, ridership actually decreased by 18% between 5 and 6 o'clock in the afternoon through the facilitation of these offers, a lower fare if they actually were able to ride the train at a different time. So think about it with our insights, right? And also with the cooperation in this ecosystem and being able to put the right offer. We're helping a city not to actually, you know, create, you know, more stations or expand or change infrastructure, but actually optimize what they have, and actually, you know, save money and speed up the flow in the process. So that's our role, probably how people don't see us working on. But it's about insights. It's about technological solutions that have this very broad range. It's about also our support as a partner, side by side with the city and within the ecosystem. And we understand that private and local authorities partnership is critical, and that's the role that we want to play.
Thank you. It's amazing, the role that you play in trying to facilitate the pain process and around the travel sector. Everything has to do with pain somehow. It is true that we're moving toward a more contactless and e-commerce and so on. But we've been very close to Mastercard in the last couple of years, cooperating in the area of data. No, and you mentioned you have an important role in providing useful insights to destinations, and cities, to understand the mobility flows, to understand what they spend, how they move. I would like you to explain a little more on this issue on what information you could provide from the point of view of the digital footprint, of those payments, to understand what they are doing. This could be also very, very useful for us, no?
Indeed, that's one of the critical pillars of our tourism strategy, is how we support merchants as well as governments in terms of insights. If you go to our website, you can actually see we issue a destination index report every year. We actually just issue a report with EA as well in terms of affluent travel. And we work with banks, governments, like that example with the city of Chicago, or recently with NYU in the United States, to actually do a special study and look at what is the commercial activity around Wi-Fi free zones and bike renting areas, just to see, you know, what having those type of facilities actually create to the shops or the commerce that moves around those areas. And actually there was a high correlation shown. So we do have definitely, you know, a lot of data. Our job is to actually create the right insights that are going to help in infrastructure decisions or on optimization of infrastructure, and also in actually our teams. We have an arm within Mastercard that actually provides a safety and security solutions. So that actually also allows us to develop those type of solutions. We also have our consulting arm, and our artificial intelligence arm, which in the previous session we talked about modeling. We do have those divisions as well. So pretty much a pretty large scope on what we can do with data, not only with our data, but also in collaboration with the data that we have, you know, from the partner that we would be working with. Our data is anonymized, is aggregated. So, and our effort is about creating insights, not just moving data or identifying data. It's all about the insight and the conclusion that will drive the right decision, the smart decisions that should be done. So that's probably the biggest shift also from the discussions yesterday, right? That were so much about big data, big data, big data. We're actually about big insights, big insights, big insights. And our focus is not just, you know, just to drop a few numbers, but actually drive, you know, you'll hear from us is what is the conclusion, you know, what is the decision that it prompts, and where should you be focused, you know, overall for your city, for your country, for your business, in terms of defining a strategy.
Okay, so let's keep in mind that MasterCard could be a relevant actor under this smart destination ecosystem, no? And the different actors that operate there, no? Thank you. Ignacio Tovar, well, you work in Iberia, no? Part of IG group. You have a difficult task to do, digitalize.
I would say challenging, right? more than difficult.
Digitalize an airline, no?
Yeah, absolutely.
Could you tell us a little bit about this digitalization strategy of Iberia, and if you could focus a little bit on the what I mentioned at the beginning on the startup initiative Hangar 51, right, which is interesting also too.
Great. So I hate slides, and that is why I brought some today. So I'm going to go and find the clicker. So I think I have like five slides that it takes me average time like 4 to 5 hours to explain. So that is why I'm going to, it's the first challenge for me. So I just brought like three or four thoughts in order to think about it a bit and to understand which is our main vision and challenges and the kind of things that we are tackling during this year. So I joined the company quite not a long time ago. So it was just last year, from August, September. I used to be a venture capitalist. So I used to work together with the startups investing in Southern Europe. I used to be, before that, a consultant, so my best friend just founded a company called La Nevera Roja in Spain, which is a kind of Deliveroo or Just Eat in Spain, and they had an exit of 100 million in 2015, so I thought, well, it's a good idea to try and be close to that, and so I joined the company and started investing in e-commerce and marketplaces companies there, and not so long ago, just one of my contacts at Iberia just suggested me to be part of this project, so I thought it was one of the most interesting things that I could do professionally and personally. And first thought is, we are all thinking about Internet of Things, virtual reality, blockchain, and these kind of things, but are we really prepared to these kind of things? And that is that slide. So which are the main difference between big corporations and startups? So that is what I call the decalogue, or the top high level characteristic of a digital leader. So that is related with the speed, agility, complexity, execution, data, talent, blah, blah, blah. So you have had to decide three of those. I would say execution. So this is not about ideas and papers. I've got like a pipeline of 350 projects and ideas. So that is why you need to focus. And the ones who can execute and not discuss about blockchain, but having a node and start doing transaction in the blockchain will win the race in the next months and years, because we like speaking in days and weeks instead of years. That is something that I'm trying to change in terms of mindset. So execution, then talent, you know, startup feeling as part of something, and there is something that we need to drive inside big corporations. Inside Iberia, that is happening. I don't know why, but that is really the level of engagement of professionals is really huge, so that is really crucial. And then I would say the number nine, which is new businesses and trying to go beyond and to accept failures and failing. You know, this is something that startups does, and you need to accept that in order to take calculated risk. But you, the point here is that you can fail, but not failing after having spent 10 millions, but 20K. That's the point. So the following one. What is digital transformation for us? Is the ABCs, always be connected. Always be connected is not just about Wi-Fi and connectivity, which is also important for an airline, because we cannot be like a connectivity black hole in a long haul flight from Madrid to Buenos Aires, for example, so that is not possible. But it's just trying to be connected to our customers and to our employees. So we are trying to measure not only the level of the NPS or the experience from our customers, but also from our employees. And that is related with the next message This is all about the experience. So we try to assess, and this is something that is not new. So we are doing this like for the last 15 years, but we did it properly this time. And so to try and understand the customer journey and the number of interactions that we have with our customers, and the which of them are really digital. And just having a call to a call center, it is not digital. So are you using a digital channel to do all these things? And then we understand that in the interaction with the customers, there is something behind that. So internal processes is what in the UK we would say above the wing or below the wing. So it's what is happening at the airport, for example, with our customers, but also what is happening when you look outside the window and there's someone just introducing fuel in the aircraft or just managing the luggage. So we need to understand also the journey of our pilots or our cabin crew, people from the staff from the airports and wherever. So that concept of the operations behind our digital customer journey are critical for us. And then being tech early adopters. So you need to understand the trends, need to understand the technology, and having influence on the evolution. So in my opinion, and being so massive as an airline and Iberia is, so we need to lead the change. And we need to train also our customer. If our customer is not digital, we need to make them understand that the digital experience is huge and that can be a game changer. And it's like what they call the stickiness of the model. So when you try something special and you really like it, so you are there and you will never go back to the experience before that one. So I think that is critical. And then I just, in order to mention some of the trends that we understand are critical, this chatbot, voice, big data again, appifying the company. So it's the only way to try to work in what they call multi-speed IT. So you've got your legacy system and many things that you want to do on top of it, and it's always the same challenge. So how do I do a chatbot if I have to just get data from my legacy booking system, which is from the 80s, for example, right? And I think that is really interesting. If I had to highlight one, I think that voice is going to be a game changer. So I don't think it's a trend. I strongly think that is the future. So use the voice to do many things. You can use the voice to manage transactions through your app. You can just be integrated in the Google Home, Alexa, and whatever. I think that's going to be a game changer, and it is, in fact, today. And trying to finalize, and having focus on what you said, we are part of IAG as a group. IAG is coordinating an acceleration program to work together with a startup. I would say a collaboration more than an acceleration. It's just in order to execute things in a short time. So in 10 weeks, I start with a startup, and in 10 weeks, I need to have an MVP, a version one of our products, to test live with a customer. So there's actually a program going on with British Airways in London, but the previous one, which was early this year, was with Iberia Express, and Vueling in headquarters Madrid and Barcelona. And those are four examples of startups that we collaborated with. And we finally did and this MVP, which is the key metrics of the success of the program, so what you've done after that 10 weeks. We did something with all of them. So Volante is a post-booking optimization tool. It's just you get an email, for example, that you are flying to LA on Saturday, change your flight to Sunday, and you get an incentive. You get an upgrade, for example. And what is behind that is the management of the offer and the capacity from an airline, so which is really critical for us, for example. Many examples. DestiGo is a chatbot, so we are even launching this during this month with our customer to do some things. A platform is just payment in installments for an airline. As you will see, there are some of them that are really disruptive. Others are not big disruption, so we're not going to change the industry with Aplazame, for example, but it's the typical example of execution. So we just integrate with the tool of Aplazame and with their API in 1 week. So it was a 1 week integration. to just provide this solution to our customers. And then in Flight VR is taking virtual reality glasses on board. So it was quite a difficult program, but we finally did a trial from Madrid to Tel Aviv to do many things. So you can play, you can watch a short film, you can see the products or the aircraft, you can see information on destination. If you're flying to Norway, you can see it there. So it's there are just some examples of the things. And that is my point of view as a head of all this, coordinated with IAG, is that this makes no sense for us if it is just PR, so just to take a photograph with a guy in his sport shoes and long hair, so it's not just about that. It is not. We are not in the position of being like a venture capital fund, like a corporate venture capital to invest in. In fact, IAG invested in, and this is public information, in Volantio, so we are now part of the equity of Volantio. I think our position is something in the middle, so just collaborate, just do things, have the right sponsorship, and execute. That is the main purpose of all this. And sorry, I think that it took me too long. But, you know, I have some more slides, but I think it's over for me. The kind of things that we do these four things. Digital mindset, so what is the internal change of our corporations. I thought at the beginning that this was not so cool as the other one, as the last one, which is innovation and new businesses. For me, after almost a year at Iberia, that is innovation. So real innovation is trying to get to the digital mindset of your organization, and this is the biggest challenge, I would say. Then Hangar 51, and then in the middle, digital customer and operations, so changing our digital journey, and then IT revolution, and that is critical. So you need to change your IT to evolve your IT to be as fast as myself want to be. So thank you so much.
Thank you. So very, very quickly, but probably from those four things that you identify there, the most difficult thing to change, maybe it has to do with culture, or when you are trying to boost digital transformation, no, mm-hmm. in a traditional airline, mm-hmm. from those different elements, no, culture, mm-hmm. Business models, innovation on internal processes. Yeah.
If I had to order them in terms of complexity and difficulty, I would say first one is culture. I would say that the second one is maybe IT. The third one, it could be trying to change the processes. But just because of our industries, you know, we are just an aviation industry, and some things cannot be changed quickly because you need to change it as a whole and work together with other airlines, with IATA and with these kind of things. And then the last one was innovation, but just because something really important happened is that our CEO and our management committee were part of the screening committee of the startups, and were part of the pitch day, were part of the demo day, so they were really involved. So people just started this because someone told them, you need to do it, so just do it. And then when we start working, people started understanding that this was really a cool thing, that we could get to somewhere, and now the whole company is engaged, and I could say it was, you know, one of our best success from the very beginning of this transformation. And again, I think this is going to happen. It's going to change into an open innovation program. So Hangar 51 will still be there, but we are actually working outside the program with other startups to do some things. We have our lost and found as a company is now managed almost end to end by a startup called FoundSpot. So the chatbot is a company from Paris, so it's like a 1.5-year-old company that raised big funding, but they are absolutely great. So these kind of things were really interesting for us.
Okay, thank you. Ignacio, so probably from one of our largest airlines in Spain to one of our largest passenger road transport companies in Spain. How do you see the challenges that you have ahead as an industry in the road transport link with smart mobility, with those new technologies, with the new business models arriving, and under this umbrella of smart destinations? What's your vision?
Well, thank you very much, Carlos. Well, our point of view is really very close to Iberia. Iberia, we are sharing a lot of things. I think the point of view of the customer for us is critical. As Ignacio has told before, the experience of the customer for us is a pillar. Why is a pillar? Because till now, till not many years ago, the demand has been adapted to the transport offer. This is changing, and this has to change a lot. We have to adapt to the demand. The demand is asking for their own experience, their own habits, and we have to adapt to it. This is a pillar for us. This, the pillar for us is the customer. We have to be focused on that. We have to get to the habit of the customer through the digitalization, and this is in our strategic. We have to think about what is first. Is first the smart destinations? Is first the future of the transport? I think we have to work together. I think there's a big achievement for the smart destinations to promote their destination in a whole offer of destinations that are all over the world. And this will be only achieved if the authorities are able to do many agreements with public and private companies, public and private initiatives. We have to work together. The destination is a whole matter of a lot of its transport, its gastronomy, its culture, its transport, of course, and everything has to be together into the same pot. How do we see nowadays the future of transport? We see that we have to focus on the client. We have to focus on the client through the experience. The experience, till not many years ago, has been approached through the experience in the customer inside of the bus. For example, for us, I mean, it's similar in a plane. We know very well what our client wants in the bus, but what we have to think about is that, about future, is what our passenger is demanding before arriving the bus and before and after arriving, leaving the bus. There are many companies, many technology companies. We have someone here, like TomTom. Other is Telefonica, for example. I mean, all the phone companies, we have big data about the experience and the habits of our customer. I mean the population in general, which all of us need the transportation needs. And these companies like TomTom, maybe he will talk about, they are doing hot maps about the mobility. Telefonica as well knows better than everybody which is the need of the customer to move from point A to point B, what time, how do they move, what do they need for that movement. And when I talk about the customer, I think that we have to work with alliance of big companies, and we are doing all that. What's the future of transport about bus companies? Well, I think everybody is thinking about autonomous vehicles, but it's not only autonomous vehicles. We have to think about connected vehicles, we have to think about autonomous vehicles, and we have to think about electric power vehicles. And this is not really very close. I think all of us would like to be closest to that future, but connected vehicles, it's indeed do it, but it's not improved. I can tell you that one of our buses probably has more than 5 SIM cards on board, which is absolutely unprofitable and not has no sense. We should need only one SIM. This is a matter of why this kind of agreements with all technological companies are not working enough. It's connected, but it's not well connected. It's going to be connected because it needs to fulfill the habits of the customer. We have to inform the customer where is the bus. The pedestrian has to inform us where is it, how is it approaching the bus. We have to connect it with the infrastructures, the signal lights, for example. We have to inform about traffic jams. There's a mass of connection about that. Of course, payment methods, of course. This is really very important. About autonomous, it's a big deal. It's a big deal. There is more than 5,000 patents in the last done till last year. The patterns about change of lane, preventing any kind of breaks, of course about dangers or whatever. They are working on that future of autonomous vehicles, but these autonomous vehicles depends on the technology of communications. 5G technology, which is supposed to arrive in the first of the 20s, more 21st than 20, it's a pillar for getting an autonomous vehicle, but it will not arrive in the 20. Of course, we would like all of us would like to get it, but it's not a reality. And last of all is electric vehicles. Well, the data that we have is in the 30s, the cost of a battery and the autonomy of a battery will decrease in a 50% of the cost of that we have currently. For the 40s, we expect, for the 50s, we expect a 75% of penetrations in vehicles of electric power, but not before. And of course, all of us have to think about a gap between the industrial vehicles and the private vehicles. Private vehicles are at least 5 years ahead than industrial ones. And that's how we see the panel.
Okay, well, you mentioned a lot of things. We don't have too much time, but do you mention issues that allow us to get into what Julio is going to share with us? We are talking about electric cars and vehicles. We are talking about new contactless payment systems and technologies to facilitate mobility. We are talking about a smart transport. But you need Julio networks, no? You need these smart grids, no? You need probably what Ericsson is doing. If you could just tell us, if you could talk a little bit about this concept of network society that I mentioned.
No, I don't know what to do because this was not prepared, but you mentioned a lot of things that was attacking me, by the way. Because my first slide is related with autonomous car. And yes, I can be agreed that it will not be here tomorrow. And understand the reasons. There are many reasons for that. There are reasons related with the public safety, security. And also, I think that for the public car, for the autonomous car, we need the support of 5G and artificial intelligence. And can I agree with you, for instance, in this case, because I will come back to your question related with the network, but for instance, you were Tesla, they are stopped with the autonomous car pilot because of the recent accidents, okay? You can see here an example of one of the last accidents that they have in the autonomous car that was, you know, not connected car in that case. It was the truck coming in one direction, the Tesla coming in the other direction, the Tesla passed through the truck. But if that car was connected, I would not say that 5G is the solution, but working together, you know, with the technology in the car, with the network, maybe will improve that. Because you mentioned that also, connected infrastructure, connected the traffic light, connected everything. Because for me, the digital transformation, it is how to connect all the players that we are sitting together here. That's part of my role. It is before the bus, before the airplane, monetizing that, we need to put all the ecosystem together. We need to start talking not about to be connected with my customer or my employee, but also with the customer of the other ones. How do we connect it with other domains, with other ecosystems? We need to work on that. And we're a technology enabler for that. This is a small example of, a short example of that. Example, it's not a car, it's like you say, it's connected the car with the infrastructure, with a helmet, with a CD, using platform also. This is creating value mesh, ecosystem working together. This is the game that we are trying to play in this game. And now I come into your sector. This is not the future, this is a present. This is something that we have been doing in Talavera de la Reina. This is small one, just starting with, as a pilot, yes. But it's connecting this bus for moving around in an autonomous way, not driver into that. And also is also creating the ecosystem, because that company, Carmedia, that was working with us, they also provide what they call the fifth screen. Because now you remember, you started with the movies, with the TV, PC, the mobile, and now the fifth screen could be the car, into the car. You can have broadband and you can share a lot of contact because you are in the car and you don't need to drive. As you say, it's a pilot, it's not there yet. This is another video that I will skip, you will miss because of the time reasons, sorry. It's a very nice one. It's related to a 5G mobility test in a driving rust blackout session, but you will not see it. Sorry. But it's a really good one. It's the best one of the presentation. I will not stop here, but also for that reason, for me, it's important, and this is like only to show that the telco provider, the network provider, Telefonica, you mentioned, they need to work together with in the digital transformation with the sector and industry, because it's where the revenue will come. Because just providing a pipeline is not enough. We need to work together to increase the value for all of us, okay? Okay, it's better to come to the video, maybe. Well, I will not stop here, sorry, because it's related with the same. Oh, God. Okay. This is also related, as I say, what we need to connect, what we are working is the technology enable the connection with the different sectors, with the different industry. And we need to identify application cluster, what will be the best one, how to start, because it's important, because everybody's talking about 5G, but 5G will provide different services depending on the sector, because you have critical sector, you have broadband, you have mass stuff, and you can share some data and share that you should not share, because imagine the security authority, they will not share all the data, but they will collect some data. We need to understand what cluster, what application can be shared, and how the technology will enable that. Just because everybody's talking about 5G, and you say that 5G will be in our expectation, in our test, we have already 5G network deployed. But it's also important to know, and that is also important for the collaboration, because if you are talking for Telefonica, Telefonica is not only working with us. They are working with the other providers, okay? And we need to work together, because you need to work along the city and to have access to all the technology. But there are network already in 5G, but some of the services that can be provided, because there are full compatibility between 4G and 5G. Okay, 5G, what is mandate, one of the advantages, is designed for connected sector industry with different capability, slicing, cutting the network. For instance, you have mobile broadband here, okay, for sharing content. In the same network, in the same infrastructure, but in a different network, you have massive matching time of communication, connecting meters, something mentioned meter, and something not critical, some positioning or whatever. In some cases, massive time, critical machine time of communication, critical related with the smart grid, with the electricity, with the availability of electricity, security, etc., or specific to the industry. This is the advantage that 5G will bring. It's improved in the capability of data, latency, number of devices that be connected at the same time. And also something mentioned, someone mentioned, I don't know who was you, is we are working also in the standard to facilitate how to share that information, not only the network standard. We're working with the chipset, we need to work all together. For me, the new dream here, the new stuff also with the city, with the ecosystem, with the mobility, is that we, the new era, the new, the people are talking about digital transformation, Industry 4.0, is that we need to be really more collaborative. In the city, connecting that car, the bus, everything that we discussed before, sharing that information, taking always into account the data privacy and security. I'm not saying that we not should take that into account, but we need to share the value, how to increase the value. And this is not the past. This case here is, I have only one more slide. This is a case in Sweden, okay, that we are connected actual cars that they have the onboarding computer, and that was not prepared to be connected. But we are connected to improve that, the maintenance, the insurance policies, okay? But as we are connected the onboarding computer of the current cars, I mean, this is a service that Telia is providing right now in Sweden, okay? Then we are enabling Wi-Fi to the car. We are enabling that car also some content to the car. It's some kind of, with the current technology, with the current car, we are working, as you mentioned before, in connected car and improving the services of the car and reducing also some accidents because we can geoposition the car, current cars, but with the technology embedded into the car. And also, as we say, this is actual today. It's the train, but in the train you can see the different context that you mentioned before. I mentioned before, you can see the broadband gigabyte for the passenger, but you have real-time location, you have real-time surveillance videos. But yesterday I was really frustrated because I was in the airport coming from here, and they were putting the match between Argentina and Nigeria, and that was not real. There was a problem in the bandwidth. That's really frustrating when you're trying to watch a football match, well, in my case, and was not the. This is what the conclusion for me, two conclusions is we need to work together. We need to work, we as an enabler, you as part of the industry, you as part of the monetization, all the ecosystem need to work together. And the technology is already here and is evolving very quickly.
Interesting to see how we have in this panel some members of the traditional travel industry together with new actors coming from the technology side and coming from the network providers side. We have been very intensively working in Spain in the development of the first 5G lab specialized on the development of travel services. We launched it last year together with IFEMA, one of the largest exhibition centers in Spain. And we are working closely with Ericsson, with Telefonica, a research group called Five Tonic. So I think we should get used to incorporate in our discussions, in our projects, in our governance models, this kind of new actors, no, of new companies that traditionally have been outside the view of the travel sector, and we have just 5-10 minutes, our later speaker. So MasterCard, it's not just a card credit a company, and TomTom, it is not anymore a GPS provider company.
Yes.
What is TomTom about?
Thanks, Carlos. I think, yeah, that's a good introduction. Thank you. A lot of people know TomTom for the GPS navigators. Nobody uses that anymore. I think some small places in Europe they are still using. But TomTom had to reinvent itself, and it didn't start last year. It's been happening for 10 years already. And TomTom today is basically and mainly a data provider, a service provider. We gather data from our own sources, our partners, automotive partners, mobile partners, and this allowed us to collect trillions and trillions of data and open a lot of doors for TomTom. Today we are mainly from a consumer company, we became a B2B company, and we work with service integrators, transportation companies, smart city programs, payment network companies, and so on. Today, I brought a very concrete use case, TomTom OD analysis, the origin and destination solution we have. And I wanted to do something very local. And one of the use cases of OD analysis has been various and numerous cases to use origin destination analysis is tourism. So that was the perfect hook. I selected 16 areas in Asturias, and we created OD analysis. We gather a lot of data in Asturias and added value because, as our colleague said, it's not only about data anymore. There's a lot of data everywhere. It's about insights. It's about what you do with the data, the value that you add, all the analytical. So these are the areas that we saw in the previous slide. And one thing that TomTom is not a tourism company for sure, but we can deliver a lot of data and a lot of insights that will help and will power tourism decisions. So for example, just as a quick, super quick analysis, we're not tourism experts. We just defined some areas and we said, yeah, let's try to see. And I made a seasonal comparison using one of those 16 areas. And if you select Oviedo as a destination, you will see that the percentage coming from Oviedo in the winter and in the summer changes a lot. So this is also very important for tourism planning, capacity planning, infrastructure planning, mobility, smart mobility between these tourism areas, not only to prepare for a big capacity, but also to spread. Maybe you want to promote a different area for to be a better destination. Another example is Oviedo as well, winter and summer. You will see that there's areas that are almost four times higher in different seasons. So the one from 0.9% and the other one, it went up to 4%. So it's four times different, four times the volume of people going to Oviedo in different seasons. This is very helpful to plan, and it's all data driven. Huh? So TomTom collecting data and adding value by analyzing trips, by analyzing the probe traces and the trips, where it starts, where it ends. We provide this. You can combine this data with other data that you might have, census, economic data, and public transportation data. Easily, if you see, you can easily see between the 16 areas selected which one has more volume of trips. So this also helps if you want to spread out the tourism attractions across your province, your state. You can also better prepare. Another important study that you can do is about the coastal area in Asturias. That was another example that we thought about. And you can easily see throughout the whole coast of Asturias where we have more flow, less flow, where people like to go more, and so on. Again, this is the TomTom OD analysis, origin destination, powered by TomTom data. We add the value, we create derivative products. This is coming out tomorrow as a web app. It's also an API service. If you want to integrate in your own platform, in your existing platform, you don't have to get rid of all your solutions. You just integrate the APIs coming later in August. And I really invite you all to go to developer.tomtom.com. You can use the APIs for free as an evaluation and just play around and see the power of the data. Yep, that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. We run out of time. I'm so sorry because the discussion, we open somehow a discussion that maybe we could continue during the coffee. Most of them, they will be available at least till lunch. So just keep this message on your mind. It's important to incorporate those new actors in your tourism strategies to incorporate all those new concepts. It is not just about technology, but it is also about culture, change. It has to do with issues related with smart networks. It has to do with issues related with using those already existing smart data platform providers, no? So let's use them, no? Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very, very much for that. That was quite fascinating. Can I ask your forbearance just for a minute while we bring your colleagues through from the other room?